Quantum physics was born in 1900 when Max Planck proposed that energy is absorbed not continuously, but in discrete packets called quanta. His idea was further developed, Einstein's explanation of the photoelectric effect, Rutherford's experimental proof of the atomic nucleus's existence, and Heisenberg and Schrodinger's development of quantum mechanics. Understanding quantum physics is challenging. It's almost impossible to translate its mathematical framework into human language. However, we can experience its manifestations in everyday life. Technologies like lasers and flash drives emerged thanks to quantum physics. It's logical that this field has been tapped for computing in quantum computers. Quantum computers are fundamentally different from regular ones. They process information orders of magnitude faster and have exponentially more memory. Experimental models today solve certain problems faster than the most powerful supercomputers. But what are they? And how do they work? Hello, dear friends. In today's video, we'll tell you about quantum computers and explore whether they truly represent our future. But before we begin, we'd like to ask you to subscribe to our channel and click the notification bell to stay updated on new intriguing videos about the mysteries of our world. A quantum computer is a computational machine that utilizes the laws of quantum mechanics, entanglement, and superposition. It sounds complex, and indeed it is, so let's break it down. From our school computer science courses, we remember that modern computers operate in binary. The unit of information is a bit, which can have two values, 0 or 1. Logical operations with bits perform all computer magic. You listen to music, watch videos, or generate cat pictures with AI. Physically, a bit looks like a tiny transistor which operates quite primitively. It can only turn on or off, like a bulb in a Christmas garland. Yet, it does this so rapidly and in such close coordination with other bulbs that it enables the computer to perform complex calculations almost at the speed of light. This system has proven itself well. Practically all modern devices, from smartwatches to smartphones, from home PC to supercomputers, operate on transistors. However, it's not without drawbacks. There are problems that seem simple, but make even the most powerful machines struggle. A classic example, imagine you're a traveling salesman, earning a living by visiting homes and selling multi-cookers. You need to devise the shortest route that allows you to visit several major cities at least once and return home. In front of you is the famous traveling salesman problem, which is much trickier than it seems at first glance. If the number of cities exceeds 66, a regular computer would need billions of years to solve it by simple brute force. This is where quantum computers come in, capable of solving such problems millions of times faster than conventional ones. The key difference is that quantum computers use qubits instead of familiar bits. Physically, these are not transistors, but quantum particles, usually photons or protons. Unlike a bit, qubits cannot only be 0 or 1, but can also take any values in between. Thanks to this, a quantum processor can perform comparably more operations in a single cycle. Now, let's delve into how a quantum computer operates. As we noted earlier, a quantum computer leverages two classical concepts from quantum mechanics, superposition and entanglement. But what are they? Superposition is the ability of a quantum particle to exist in multiple states simultaneously. Superposition has an intriguing property. It collapses immediately upon observation. Imagine tossing a coin and watching it spin. You can't say for certain whether it's showing heads or tails. It's spinning. What is going on? Someone stop this. But the moment you clap your hand over the coin, everything becomes clear. A qubit behaves similarly. Until you measure it, it remains simultaneously in all states between 0 and 1. It sounds strange, but it's one of the main tenets of quantum mechanics. Superposition sparks much debate in scientific circles. Take, for instance, Schrodinger's famous cat paradox, which is either alive, dead, or simultaneously living in several parallel universes. Superposition alone isn't enough for computations. Qubits must be entangled. If in a regular machine, conducting pathways play this role. In a quantum computer, quantum entanglement comes to our aid. For example, in laboratory conditions, we can obtain several photons in an entangled state. Wherever these photons end up, even at opposite ends of the universe, they remain interconnected. If you alter the state of one, the others entangled with it will change simultaneously. It sounds like magic, but it's a real physical law. With its help, scientists have learned to teleport quantum states over many kilometers. But why is a quantum computer better than a classical one? Due to the fact that qubits can exist in multiple states simultaneously and are interconnected, quantum machines can concurrently explore all solution possibilities, unlike classical computers, which iterate through possibilities sequentially and quite slowly. You can think of this like a kaleidoscope. If, with a classical computer, you need to turn the device to see different patterns, a quantum computer has already spun everything and assembled it into one large canvas. Now, you just need to extract the desired fragment. Here's where the complexities begin. Quantum computers don't output exact results, but probabilistic ones, approximating reality. Therefore, special quantum algorithms are required for interpretation. Such algorithms already exist, but they are tailored to solve narrow mathematical problems and are thus less applicable in real-life scenarios. Translating real human problems into quantum language is not straightforward, partly why such machines won't become mainstream anytime soon. Another challenge is decoherence, when a particle loses its properties upon interacting with the external world. The thing is, superposition is delicate and anything can disrupt it, from a solar storm to climate change. So, you can't just cover everything with a copper lid and thermal paste. You need much more serious isolation. Developing such isolation is a separate technological challenge. Currently, the only working method is to cool the entire system to absolute zero to shield it from external influences. This is usually done using liquid nitrogen, ion traps, or magnetic fields, making the cooling system quite hefty. Just take a look at IBM's first commercially available quantum computer. The main takeaway is this. Quantum computers are undoubtedly more powerful than classical ones, but they're still far from mastering everything. Additionally, they are quite complex to manufacture. However, scientists are confident that this is surmountable. Just remember how much space the first Mark I computer occupied. Quantum computers have moved beyond the realm of theoretical models, being built and operational for some time now. Many companies and research institutions have such machines. For example, IBM has its Osprey computer, consisting of 433 superconducting qubits, which perform computational operations with 99% accuracy in 10 nanoseconds. Similarly, Google possesses the Sycamore computer with fewer qubits and computational speed, but boasting 99.9% accuracy. But why do we need quantum computers at all? Let's be clear. Quantum computers are still too raw to solve concrete practical problems on a mass scale. Everything discussed next relates more to distant forecasts. A quantum computer can create a new chemical compound and calculate its interaction with existing structures. Classical, even super powerful, computers cannot quickly tackle such a task. It's estimated that modeling a molecule of 70 atoms would take a classical computer around 13 billion years, whereas a quantum computer would do this in just a couple of minutes. In practice, such modeling is in demand in genetic engineering, in the development and creation of new drugs and materials. Building optimal routes, distributing heat and light supply, predicting demand and other complex combinatorial problems are well within the capabilities of quantum computers. As well, we can consider meteorology. Currently, weather predictions in most meteorological centers are handled by classical supercomputers based on models consisting of hundreds of thousands of lines of code, yet even the most powerful machines cannot account for all nuances. For quantum computers, instant exploration of multiple variables and indicators is trivial, which is why meteorologists place high hopes on them. Quantum technologies have enormous disruptive potential. Many companies are already creating prototypes of real quantum computers. They can do something, but it's still not enough. However, once such machines learn to solve even one optimization problem, it could transform entire industries. Hopefully, in a few years, we'll witness a new world full of real technological wonders. Thank you very much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it and subscribe to the channel to stay updated on new intriguing videos about the mysteries of the universe and our planet. Let us know in the comments what you'd like to learn about in the next video. Thank you and see you next time.